मैं इंडिसेशन क्रश
Yeah, please, Mohan. Yeah. So, friends, now we are coming to the third leg of today's session. We have a wonderful speaker in the form of Ashok Kumar from Punjab University. Harpreet Singh, our secretary, a finance secretary, would introduce Ashok. Those members who have joined outside this integrated bioinformatics workshop, so please exit the session, please. This talk will also be recorded and you can find it in the YouTube page later. Okay, so request all the other participants who have not registered for the workshop to exit this. Yeah, thank you so much. So Harpreet, would you please introduce Ashok? Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, good evening. Good evening, everyone. I hope my voice is clear.
Yeah, very much, very much. And I see you are in San Francisco. Oh, wonderful.
You know, I'm virtually traveling to San Francisco. So in the world of virtual things, so I think I have set a virtual background. I don't know when I will get a chance to go to San Francisco, but I'm in the virtual background. Thank you very much.
Please.
And wonderful workshop is going on. And is Ashok there? Prash, I just wanted to hear, just joined.
Yeah,
Ashok Kumar, welcome Ashok, welcome.
Now I'm virtually. Sorry,
Ashok, your voice is not clear. Will you find in your speakers breaking somewhat?
Hello, what about now? Yeah. Right now?
Is no, that no,
clear
it's fine.
Right now or not?
Perfect. Now it's perfect, Ashok.
No, it's...
Okay, so without wasting any time, in the series of different workshops and talks during this very innovative initiative by BioQuiz and also supported by Hansraj Mahila Mahavidyalaya Jalandhar, I, Harpreet Singh, Finance Secretary of BioQuiz, on behalf of BioQuiz, on behalf of HMB, I welcome my very good friend Ashok Kumar. Ashok Kumar from Center for Systems Biology and Bioinformatics, Punjab University, Chandigarh. Ashok Kumar has done MSc in Bioinformatics, PhD Diploma in Bioinformatics, and PhD in Cancer Biology. So he is a person of cancer biology. His area of expertise include cancer biology, computational structure and system biology by molecular modeling and molecular dynamic simulation, network biology, and computer-aided drug design. He is not only teaching, but also involved in a lot of other activities or having a lot of other responsibilities in the university. He is the chairperson of the Center for System Biology and Bioinformatics. He's an assistant professor at Center for System Biology and Bioinformatics. And he has a lot of publications in very reputed journals across the world. He has been very active in promoting the field of bioinformatics. And I just joined a group created by him to do one of the integrated project in bioinformatics. I hope I will contribute more in that project. And really, I really like the approach towards the student, towards the research Ashok is having. And I think we are very lucky to have Ashok amongst us today. So without wasting any time, I welcome again Ashok. And I request everybody to give a big round of applause to Ashok. He will be talking about role of system biology tool cytoscope in understanding protein-protein interaction. And I know it's very useful for the students and also for the researchers who are looking to have protein-protein interaction, looking to study protein-protein interaction. So welcome, Ashok. Welcome on board. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Harpreet. And it is always a pleasure to talk to our junior, senior, the person who belong to the same universities. So we share our pain and happiness because Harpreet is also from the Guru Nanak Dev University. And I've been to there, that place also. So thank you very much. And I'm really happy to listen the sweet words from Harpreet. And it is, I think, the second or third time we are interacting physically, but we are interacting virtually a lot of time. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for the host, Prash, and what I can say about Prash. It is being, I think, 2.5 years, I'm just following him like anything. We can just, just copying a lot of ideas from him. Recently, I have started I'll be taking maybe 1 minute to start this workshop. As such, I will be switching this video. And okay, is that okay, now?
Yeah, you can switch off the video. That improves the quality of talk.
Yeah, the reason for acknowledging Prash is only that I can see, I can really see a lot of people are doing research. I know, and then you must be having heard of people are doing research in a lot of different fields. But when I see Prash, he has a really intention to contribute. And I really see these type of qualities these days in a lot of science people are missing. So I really acknowledge in that sense. He has that zeal to teach. And then throughout this conference, I have been to witness a lot of time when he was really like, standing for the students and really like a strong master and ensuring each and everything is working in the direction and all students are completing their exercises. And saying all these things, I really want to thank each and every person who is participating in BioClues, and I am very happy to be part of that. Thank you very much. Now we'll start our main business, what I am supposed to talk about. So if I say about myself, I am a biotechnologist by training, and I did my PhD from Punjab University from Human Genome Department. And after completing the PhD, I joined this department called Center for System Biology and Bioinformatics. And I was also new in the biotechnology, was just learning a lot of things. But one thing is very clear, when I see bioinformatics, a lot of things are common. It is not like that we are in for biotechnology. So when you go to these bioinformatics field, so there is lot of things are being changed. People have misinterpretation in that sense. So we have control in bioinformatics also. We also have a lot of things which can be correlated with my experience being in a completely wet lab research, where I used to do cloning, sub-cloning, and for the last 7, 8 years, I was doing these things. I was working on the cancer called prostate cancer, and we are interested in the identification of early diagnostic marker, which could be competing with the already known marker called PSA, prostate specific antigen. So from there, I was a very excited person. I joined my boss and he gave me this particular problem and we started. During the course of my PhD, I learned a lot of things. And one thing I can share with the audience right now, what is that called? That is called experimental design and how to use these positive and negative control. So this is a thing which I also used in my bioinformatics research. And this particular topic, which we will be going to present, will be divided into two parts. First of all, I will be showing you some of the slides, which I don't like, but I will to show some of the slides related to network biology. And then I will be showing the interface called, this is a graphical user interface called Cytoscape. And how can you use this, what is called network information or network biology, what are these terms, is called system biology, from where we can get this information or data related to protein-protein interaction. So I'll be demonstrating most of the time, will be contributing to show you these things, which will be used for collecting these information called protein-protein interaction. And then we'll be showing some of the databases, and then we'll be discussing on the spot. So what is the title say, the role of system biology tools? That is one of the tool is very popular, it's called Cytoscape, in understanding protein-protein interactions. So what exactly system biology, already Prash has already explained very beautifully what exactly system biology. So if I can repeat this system biology, this all about understanding of biological molecules on all level, from subcellular organelles to complete organism. So as you can see, this is a system or a human system we need to understand. And if it can be divided into different sections, so you can get an idea these sections or these different modules can be divided to understand a whole human beings in the form of your organ interactions, because the you have different organs in human beings, and then these are lungs, heart, and so you can understand the system of these organ interaction, and their organs consist of a lot of different types of cell types. These are neuronal cells in neurons, and your heart cells and liver cells. Then there are a lot of interaction we can study at the system level, what is called cellular networks, how their different cells are interacting. This is also part of, we can say, the systems biology. At this level, we are understanding the cellular interaction. Then we go to the deeper level. Then at this level, it is called molecular networks. These cells contain a lot of macromolecules. As we have discussed, typically a single cell must be containing more than 28,000 of proteins, and these proteins are interacting. And then you, other than proteins, we have other macromolecules like lipids, carbohydrates, and then their combination of these different molecules. And how these macromolecules are interacting. Then at this level, this is also a system biology, but now we are understanding the interaction of protein with DNA, protein with protein, protein with RNA. And that is also will be helping to understand the concept of a whole system or human being. Then we can go further to the interaction of gene to gene interaction and protein protein interaction. So don't have to worry that these interactions are can be studied by with the simple type of algorithm which is already available in this computational sciences. What is this all called? Graph theory mechanism, where these all like social networking data are being studied or analyzed. In a typical social network, as you know, this be most popular example I can take. So you have if you consider this red person, you and you are connected with a lot of human beings, and that particular network is called social network because you are interacting socially with the all other human beings. And these are nothing, have a two feature which is can be characterized like a single circle can be called as a node, and these connection between these two human beings are called internode. And in sociology, we can say how a person is connected with your other person, maybe your brother, it may be your father, it may be other, if you have sister. So these are relationship from where this red person, or maybe Ashok, I can say, is connected with Harpreet. Then Harpreet is connected with Prash, and then Prash is connected with a lot of people. So we can have the network of Prash, which is connected with a lot of people. Then we can go to Ashok. Then Ashok also have the connection access. Maybe if the Harpreet or Prash will allow to interact with the other human beings. So the same thing are being explored to understand these macromolecular interactions. Why there is need? There is always a need for understanding data. It is only demand and supply. We have a lot of huge data after human genome are getting sequenced like anything. I can say right now, this is, I think, latest slide I have downloaded from the NCBI, which is popular database. So you have eukaryotes in 2019, as you can say, we have whole genome sequences of 29,946. Okay, in the previous it was only 39. So how many fold you can understand the data we have already got? So this is a whole genome sequence, and as the same with the other organism also. So we have a huge data set in genome, and these are also can be compared with the RNA-seq, which is called transcriptome. And then the same proteomics, that these all omics fields are originated and arise because of the availability of the genomic data. Okay, the same thing can be analyzed, and you can understand there are different level of this network, which can be easily understand by this social network example. So how there are a lot of tools are being exposed to you during this workshop, and I've been also excited to see that there are a lot of tools, maybe especially excited to see there are tools related to graphical user interface. And I love these tool. I love only two tools for the last 11 years. I'm into this field of mind, what is called system biology. So these two tools, one is called Chimera and the another is called Cytoscape. I just love these two tools because these tools, only the using of these two tools, I'm getting more than seven papers a year. And because the help of these tools, I really want to acknowledge the person who developed these type of algorithms, and they are publicly available. So these tools are called Cytoscape and is open source bioinformatics software. And this is based on JavaScript. So we are using these type of tools to understand the protein-protein interaction as well as gene-gene interaction. So I'll be demonstrating a few of the example with that Cytoscape. Okay, so what is the goal and motivation of this tool? These slides are also available at the site of Cytoscape. These are not mine slides, so I need to acknowledge. I just forgot to mention here. So these are the goal. By the end of this workshop or maybe this short talk, you'll be understanding the major application of network biology, relevant networks and pathways, how to understand these network, and then network give rise to different biological pathways. You must be aware that if the person is getting some disease, it is not like the single variable is just getting changed or single genes are maybe getting disturbed. Nowadays, these all diseases are become multivectorial or multivariable diseases. So there must be a lot of genes are getting disturbed. In the case of a cancer, we can say. So these things can be understood by using these type of technologies. Is that okay? Hello? I think somebody's switch off their mic. Okay, so what is the network biology? Why we need to network biology? Because the disease or maybe the data is very huge and it's become very complex. So we need to have some different ways, not the classical ways, to understand diseases also. So this is that is called networks. The networks are everywhere. Networks are powerful. You can see that, like what right now are interacting with you. These are through the this internet. These are one of the powerful things we are interacting, and which virtually sitting somewhere else. And maybe we are connecting more than I think 20 to 23 places. Maybe if you can say we are connecting virtually, and then the same thing are used for the understanding the biological network. So biological network is understanding the cellular communication, nervous system. I'm not going to the thing. So there a lot of things are there as a network, which this algorithm is also available. When you understand the internet, so these algorithms are based on what is called graph theory mechanism. What is molecular graph theory mechanism told? So if you have like a simple circle, and that's called as one of the node or computer. And these are connected with the other nodes. So this is called node N1, and this is called node N2. And they are connected with this called internode, or what you call this in technical term is called edges. And this is a simple example of a connection. You have one node, and this node have different attributes, which could be called as proteins, which could be called as DNA or gene, mRNA, we call it carbohydrates. And how these different nodes are interacting with the edges, and these edges also have different relationship like features. So how to analyze these type of biological network I'll be taking one of the examples to demonstrate you. So this network biology tool is an analysis of topological properties, and they must be having a lot of features to analyze these type of network. As you can see, there's a typical network. You can see a lot of different nodes are clustered, are very close to each other. And there are some nodes which are not close to each other. Then there's a concept of these, how these different analysis or the terms, all these nodes are analyzed. These are called topological properties, and there are concept of hubs and sub networks. There is a hub is of that network or that particular node where a lot of different nodes are connecting. Like in this case, you can say, this is the example where you can say, this is particular red is a hub node because this particular node is connected with the lot of different nodes. And this become a maybe interconnected with a lot of different nodes and a channel to interact with a lot of different types of, if you take an example of a protein, that it must be very important. And this is, if this particular protein will be disturbed, then the communication among all of the other protein will be totally gone. So that is called hub node, and that is what is called sub-networks. The same network has a different part. Like we have human beings, we have different parts like hands and legs. The same networks are also having different parts like sub-networks. So if you want to divide this particular network, to then be easily divided into these four sub-networks. This is the one network we can divide, this is the second network, and this is a very spreaded network, this is third, and then this is fourth network. So we can have a different understanding and analysis when we extract this type of network and we further analyze. Like we can have that, like in the case of prostate cancer or maybe in the other cancer, there are a lot of genes are being responsible for making as a molecular marker. And just consider this red portion or the red node if represent a prostate cancer molecular marker like P53. This is the name of the particular protein, and this is interacting with a lot of different proteins. If this particular protein P53 is disturbed, then all other networks and interactions are also disturbed. So these type of interpretation will be very interesting to understand when you have a different type of networks, and we can get a different type of interpretation of these networks. Then the second part, which is very important in cytoscape, it is called analysis, and third is called, well, second is called visualization. How to visualize this beautiful network? What are these colors? How to label them? How to map with the attributes? How to different change this layout? These things are very much important and very significant to represent your data, because this data is very complex. Because it is a typical network, you must be having more than 10,000 nodes. So how to organize these type of information in a different data visualization. And it's not about only visualization. These visualization are also being analyzed. This is called qualitative analytics and quantitative analytics. These numbers also demonstrate a lot of things. I'll be showing you one of the example there. So there are these networks are used in a lot of different tools, and we have a lot of beautiful papers are published, like there are application of SARS-CoV-2 human interactions, how different human proteins are interacting with these COVID virus. And there are different examples I can list. I will be going fast. So I'll be showing this particular interface called Cytoscape. So they have this graphical user interface, and I'll be showing that. So this, as you know, this is open source and there's a cross platform. It is not bound to only Windows. You can have the Mac or the Linux version is also there. As we have already discussed, like Galaxy workflows. So this is also maintained by a lot of different scientists, like consortium is there. A lot of people are maintaining this particular software. So this particular software has, this Cytoscape has three portions. I'll be showing demonstrative section. This is a main window, and there is an attribute window, and this is a file handling window. So I will be showing these things, what are these. So typically the network will consist of this main network, which consists of this red circle, it's called nodes, and then blue lines, it's called edges, how these nodes are interacting. In the case of protein-protein interaction, that is called the way of the relationship of these two proteins, where they are physically interacting or they are not physically indirectly interacting, that become the different colors. So these interaction or edges can be also labeled. We can label as a user what sort of relationship are there, but among these type of network. Then second thing will be also important with what is called tables. So you will be having networks and tables. The table consists of a lot of data. As we have discussed, you can get a gene expression data from some of the publicly available data, like we have GEO database. So we can get these gene expression data. Take an example of this normal patient versus prostate cancer. As you can see, and we want to compare the transcriptome of the one of the normal patient versus the prostate cancer patient. Now, typically, you know, there are there are 25,000 genes in a normal patient, and then you have prostate cancer, the same 25,000 genes. But when the person is getting prostate cancer, the value, the expression of these certain types of genes must be overexpressed, like the expression of genes is expressed twofold, fourfold, maybe sixfold. That is called upregulation. And there are certain genes which are not disturbed. They will be common between normal patient and the cancer patient. And there are certain type of genes, their expression will be downregulated. So you will be having the three type of variable, like normal expression, upregulated genes, and downregulated genes. And then they are further quantified. It could be one-fold, two-fold, and six-fold, seven-fold, as per the type of data we have. So these type of analysis is called differential gene expression. The gene is now differently expressed in the case of a disease condition. What I show you, maybe in the cancer, prostate cancer, the typically P53 is getting disturbed, or maybe lung cancer, we have a lot of molecular markers. So what other proteins are getting, or the genes are getting disturbed or getting downregulated and upregulated with the periphery of the P53 also. So these are the different hypothesis based question. They can be answered by these type of algorithm. So this is the typical network, and then this is there are different visualization. You can see the same network are now different colors. So yes, you can see there are different shapes and sizes also. And then the same must be this particular table are now merged with the network. Initially, these all are network have the similar size. Now this table, just consider this table contains the case of a differential expression genes where we have downloaded the P53 and their corresponding 100 genes which is highly differentially expressed, whether they are downregulated or upregulated. Then I now want to see these particular differential expression genes mapped with your network. So we can download this gene network and then protein network. Then we can map all the differential expression gene data with this particular network. Now, after mapping, we can change the attribute of this network. And we can say when the expression is twofold or fourfold, just change the color and the size of the network. So you can see by changing the mapping with the differential expression gene, now there's a lot of background is coming. Hello. So
please go ahead.
So there are a lot of when you map with the differential expression, then you have these type of nodes which are bigger in size and they are differentially colors. So these different shapes and different shapes is representing the differential expression gene, the gene which is getting highly expressed, the particular node size will be increased in that particular fold. Maybe you can compare. There are certain genes which is very less expressed and not expressed at all. So the size and the shape of the particular nodes will be similar. If the expression of this particular gene is twofold, so you can compare the same node is getting twofold increase in the size. So this visualization is also a mapping of these two data, like gene expression data and then protein interaction network. So what we can do qualitative and quantitative analysis with these type of network biology tools. Qualitative, we are just by visualization, we can see which genes must be overexpressed. So with these two genes, they could be maybe hub network or hub genes. And these genes are getting upregulated and downregulated. So they must be having some significant role in the disease phenotype. We can get an idea about just visualizing this network. And just consider we can change these type of tables maybe we can change the table for differential gene expression for prostate, lungs, or maybe kidney cancer, and then we can get the comparative networks also. Okay, this is the second scenario. We can get the differential gene expression of different disease type, and we can compare disease to disease type within the same class, maybe different types of cancer. Maybe we can compare the genetic or gene expression data between two type of disease. The person who is having prostate cancer, so want to see the gene expression data of kidney cancer also. So there are a lot of disease like comorbidity disease. So one of the disease are also the phenotype will be merged with the other type of disease. So later cross relationship data can be analyzed with this type of network tool. So you can download this is, as you know, this is open source and you can download from this particular site. So appcytosome.org. So second and a very much important part of this Cytoscape. So I think it will be stopping within 5 minutes, and then I will go for the demonstration because I want to invest maximum time in demonstrating it. So you can go to these slides and I will share this slide and you can go. So this is the main interface, and the one is a very important thing. It is called, you have the download the Cytoscape, then this is the main interface. And then other than the Cytoscape, then you have to download different applications or what is called in this called app. Like in Android app, then they have Cytoscape apps. So as you can see, these different apps have different types of function. Like if you want to collect the different types of data from different sources, then your collection tab, if you want to have different type of visualization. So there are different function or different type of function will be performed by different types of tab or apps. So I'll be showing one of the application. They have more than 3000 types of Android app or what you call Cytoscape app, which is similar to Android app. So they have different types of function. So we can use this in this Cytoscape app to analyze like network merge. There are a lot of things need to be done with this Cytoscape. So I'll be showing you how to do this called clustering, how to club different types of nodes, how to analyze nodes, how to merge nodes, and how to map with the gene expression data. If the time permit, I will show you that. So first of all, what is the code, how to load networks? So there are different types of format you have by which we can load this network. And from where we can get this data, typically there's one site called String. I'll be showing that. String is the database from where you can get the protein-protein interaction data. And there are different type of format. I will be not showing, I will not discussing that thing. So there are different type of format of a network we can have. Typically, the Excel file or TSV or CSV file can be converted into a Cytoscape network. Otherwise, we have different types of languages by which the networks are typically are saved, like SBML. So these are the very specific type of format where the networks are saved, and it can be used with the other type of interfaces other than Cytoscape. Okay. Where do you find the network? As you know, I will discuss this called database called String. Other than the String database, so there are these are the other resources. These are the other resources where you can get this type of data. So as you can say, this is MIF, PDB, and these are different types of data source from where you can get the the protein-protein interaction data. That everything is I have told you. There are different databases. Then which data type you want to download and what exactly you want to analyze with this Cytoscape. One thing is very important. What's the biological question you want to analyze? This is very important in network biology. Because you have data available, but which data you want to extract and analyze, it is very important. Like we can say in the case of prostate cancer, in our PhD, I used to search, there's a one marker called prostate specific antigen. So my specific question in PhD was, is there other markers which can be directly, we can be correlated with the PSA, which will be better than the PSA marker, which is called prostate specific antigen. This is a gene, though, which is used for the identification of prostate cancer. So we are just identifying the nearby genes. When the prostate cancer is getting onset, the phenotype is there, the level of PSA is getting high. So that is my question or the hypothesis. Is there other genes are also getting overexpressed when the PSA is getting high or upregulated? So these type of questions should be there before you download any type of data. Now there are different type of interfaces by which you can download the data. Okay. Then when you have a typical network, these are the network features you need to understand. When you have a network, this network is connected with the different nodes. There are a lot of nodes. So one of the features which is typically used is called node degree, provide information of a single node. That is a degree key, how this particular node is connected with the other nodes. If the particular node is connected with the single node, the degree will be one. If the degree is the same node is connected with the two different nodes, then degree will be two. So three or more nodes, if they are collected, and then we can say this is become motif. Like we have an example of protein sequence or structure. And these are also the same type of motif that they have inherited the same terminologies from these proteomics. So motifs is when three or more nodes are connected with each other. These are called closed nodes. They are all connected with each other. Then the third, which is important, the large group of nodes are called modules and communities. When you have more than three or four groups, that is called community. Then you can see this is a different network than this. There are different colors. It must be the red type of networks, must be having some different function than yellow, then green one. In collectively, this type of interaction network is called module. And the last one is hierarchy, describe where the structural elements are combined, where we can say there is some, how these different types of networks are connected. Okay, then there are certain things which is need to be understand in network biology. Degree is the most common used word. Now, although lots of people don't know anything other than this degree as such. So degree is the most common word people use, but there is other measures, other analytical or quantitative measures by which these networks are analyzed. The degree, as we already told you, degree is a connection with the nodes with a single node, how many other nodes they are connected. That is the degree. What is the degree of this particular node? Can somebody write on a chat? So that we can understand, are we on the same page? What will the typical degree of this particular node, red node? Very good, very good. And what about this degree of this blue node? When you want to calculate the degree, that this particular node is connected with a lot of different nodes. So directly these are connected with these four nodes. That's very good. So these are degree and betweenness. If a particular node is connected to two bigger nodes, like in this case, they are connected with these two bigger nodes. These are called subnetworks. So these are connected, these are called betweenness. Though they are also having some, they can be quantified, like centrality, betweenness. These are the numbers they have calculated. Then in the background, there must be some statistical algorithm is working. And then these type of values we can get by which we can create a lot of information. So what is called degree, betweenness, that the betweenness is the particular node is connected with these two different subnodes. Closeness, how these are closeness, centrality is also there. So these are different types of nodes, which is can be quantified with these different types of statistical parameter, like degree, node, betweenness, centrality. So the next things is what is called analytical approach to understand. I think we should stop now, and then we'll show you some of the demonstration. I think it is already half an hour is left, so it is a little better. I will go to these type of analysis. Okay. So this is a typical. This is last slide. I need to show you. So this is a typical networks. We can say these are the red are called different nodes, and they are called edge directness. So this is a property of a network. One node is not connected with the single internet is called interacting or edges. One node is going to be controlling the this node zero is controlling the features or the property of a node three. That is called activator. You must be heard of the biological network. One is a repressor, one is the activator. So this network has these type of different interpretation. These are labeled as arrow. So this node zero, this protein is activating this particular node three. So if they are typically two protein, so this is the activator which is controlling the activity of this second node three protein. And this is an inhibitor. This protein is also having different behavior with the node one, and that become inhibitor for this particular protein. Then there are multiple graph allow multiple edges between the. It is not typically that one node is only interacting with the other node. So there must be having different types of interaction. Allow multiple edges between nodes. So there is one relation like they're interacting with the one of the properties, and then the same node can be interacting with these two different type of edges or relationship. So this typical two nodes can be connected with the same edges. They can have two edges with a different relationship. Okay. So now I think we can stop this thing, and we can directly go to what you call interface. I think if you have any question at this stage, let me know. Otherwise, we are ready to go. Any questions? Any queries? Anything you want to give comment? Yes, no, understanding something or not? Hello?
Yeah, friends, you know, please utilize this opportunity in asking questions. It was a wonderful talk, Ashok. Thank you.
Okay.
I have a question. Is it okay?
Yeah, you can write now. It is perfectly okay. Just yeah. Tell me your name and then ask your question.
Yes, I'm Renuka here, and it's a really wonderful session on Cytoscape. How different it is from the string?
String, okay. Very beautiful question. How different is from string? String are also collecting these network. But string doesn't allow to manipulate and then modify this network. You cannot create your own network with your own data. That is one of the difference. Okay. Other than that, this same algorithm is working on. These are also working on the molecular graph theories. They are also using what you called nodes and internodes, which I am directly I'm showing to demonstrate the string. So I'll be showing that thing to you. So these are these networks cannot be manipulated. These can be extracted and then can be visualized in Cytoscape. So in a way, string is also having the same network, but they are different because we have a lot of scope of manipulation and changing. Rather than which this particular string database is not giving. Okay. I hope I am able to answer your question.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
I'm Esther. And does this software allow gene environment interactions to be analyzed?
Gene environment interaction. When you say environment, if it is converted into different variables, then we can do. If you can convert what you say environment, so environment, if they can be exactly defined, like what you say in an environment, if you say microscopic environment, in the case of protein studies, if this environment can be divided into a certain type of variable, like we can say if it is divided into temperature, humidity. In that sense, you are want to ask?
I was thinking of SNPs for the study.
Yes. SNP. Okay. Yes. Wonderful.
Thank you.
There are separate modules or apps where you can use SNP variation. What is the clinical importance of SNP must be there? Whether there will be impacting the network, they are disturbing the network. There will be gain of function. There is a loss of function with the inclusion of exclusion of this mutation or SNP data. Of course, we can do that.
Hi Ashok, this is Sugnakar. Thank you for a wonderful talk.
Yes.
Thank you for a wonderful talk because it's because of lack of time. I want to ask you many questions, but one question that I wanted to ask you.
Yes, please.
I think the time is allowed. Yeah. For example, when you try and understand about, as a cancer biologist, you know hallmarks of cancer. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, for example, I wanted to take one cancer taken into consideration, for example, a cervical cancer or a non-small cell lung carcinoma, right?
Okay.
And I wanted to understand its metabolic PPI. How do you go ahead with that? How do you understand that particular network?
What right now I can say, we are studying one of the network or metabolomics network from one of our collaborator in Winnipeg. So what he has a typical metabolomic data of Leydig syndrome. This is a rare genetic disorder. So you want to show whether this particular syndrome has some of the proteins which is differentially expressed or maybe interacting differently. So if you have a metabolomic data of the two cases, you must be having the cases of control versus test or maybe disease. Then we can get a comparative studies. Then second thing is also possible, but is very interesting. These are called dynamic networks. If you have a time scale data also, like if the some of the disease are getting progress with the time, and we have a differential expression of the different time, like this particular gene of the, one of the patients are tested for early stage, then late stage, and then middle stage. And then same transcriptome data can be mapped with the same network, and you will see as a dynamic network which type of genes are getting more interacting lively, like a real dynamic molecular dynamic data. We can also have a dynamic network. Please go ahead. What you are asking? Sorry, it's
no. That's the same thing. Like the previous question that was asked by one of the participants. Can we correlate the SNPs?
Yes, 100%. Very popular. Very popular application of SNP. We have there's a lot of clinical SNP versus non. We can categorize these different data of SNP, which is very important, clinical significance and non-clinical significance, and we can get this data in a tabular form. And this data can be mapped with the known network of a human proteome or maybe human genome or gene network. It is not we have to collect only protein network. We have a data set for gene mania where we can get the data of gene interaction. I will show you one of them. This is also the second data. This is where you can get the gene interaction. So if you have a one p53, maybe which is importantly having a lot of variation, like so a lot of genes and mutation and SNP variations are there in cancers. So you can get all these data from these type of databases, and then you can map your own individual clinical variation. This is a normal gene network, and then you can your user-defined data make particular table and then map. They will beautifully show these type of networks are being shown very beautifully.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashok. Certainly, I'll get back to you. Thank you so much.
Dr. Ashok, I have one question.
Yes, please.
Have you tried to work with the machine learning and the network descriptors?
Yes, sir. I worked one of the project with QSAR and pharmacophore modeling. So what we worked, this is also having a informatic plugin in Cytoscape. So what I was interesting, so these, I need to extract the features of these drugs, which have in common functional group and shapes. And then I need to, the machine learning part was not there, but I need to understand the pattern of the known drug, which is cancerous and non-cancerous. What sort of interactions like hydrogen bonding and non-hydrogen bonding is there in this pattern, signatures, or maybe what is so common type of interaction is there with the, so I just analyzed that thing. So there are possibilities of machine learning. I didn't try. Sorry to say that we have a lot of molecular dynamics data. I need to do that, that thing.
Okay. Maybe we can discuss further on this. Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. Yes. So can I share my screen right now? I think we can.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, please. Yeah.
So what is right now on your screen? It is called string data. So I will be showing you. So I think we have 20 minutes. I will be fast to show you some of the things we can get. So this is a typical interface of a string database. When you search this P53, and then automatically will identify the organism name. That's a very comparative proteomics study we can do. Like we have to understand the network of P53 in a human being versus the model organism, like we can do with the mouse, we can do the model organism like Drosophila, we can do with the rat, we can do with the C. elegans. So there's a lot of things we can do with the comparative proteomics also. So I've searched one of the protein, which is gene, which is very important and very favorite to my boss also. He did a lot of work on these P53 mutations. So what do you just want to search the network of these P53 in human beings? When I click this network, so you got, this is a typical network we got. So somebody in the audience must be asking how they are different from the Cytoscape. They are doing the same thing. What I am saying, we can modify a lot of things. If you want to delete this particular node, what will be the effect of the centrality? What will be the different cluster will be forming? If this is a very important node, this type of simulation cannot be done with this part of data. Like you can say, when you're stretching it, there are a lot of interaction with this particular P53 because this is our query protein. And these are all our the protein which is also interacting with your P53. It is obviously because these is the query, and on the basis of query, we are getting a lot of different interacting partners. Now there are a lot of things we can do. So there are few tabs, you can say there are a lot of different legend like nodes, edges, attributes. And you can see in the background of this color, there are some pictures also being shown. That picture is nothing. They are showing these nodes are this P53 also have this protein is characterized. What are there? They are all relational databases. So this string database is also getting information from PDB. And you can that this particular protein P53 structure is already characterized and known. And it is interact with the other MDM2, MDM4, and their structure is also known. So you can get an idea within the same interface, you are getting a lot of information. And how they are different colors. So these are different attributes you can get. What are the meaning of these attributes? So what is called edge attributes. So you have different types of meaning, we can say, how they are interacting. Though they are differently colored. There are known interaction, predicted interaction, and others. So these interactions are having different experimentation. I will be not boring you to show you what sort of experimental validation where people establish where this one protein is interacting with the other. So there are called known interaction. These are called curated databases. These are called experimental driven protein-protein interaction. What we called in network biology, this is called quality data with highly significance because these are very known interaction and they are already curated one and validated by experimental generation. There are what you say we have a lot of other type of interaction also, which is predicted, like gene-gene neighborhood. There are certain genes which, if you physically map, these gene must be a part of the same chromosome and same strand, or they are very near to each other. So they can predict they must be interacting with each other. So there, that is a one of way of predicting this gene-gene interaction or protein-protein interaction. There must be a gene fusion event, like you can say paralogous genes are there. The same is gene during the speciation is divided into and then expressed in the different species. That is called gene fusion event. There are certain genes are coming from different species and then expressed in one of the different single species and then combined. So there are different types of changes by which we can see whether this gene fusion event or they are occurring in the same cellular location, there could be possibility of interacting these two nodes. So there are different colors. Then there is a last window. They're also very important. What is called text mining. These are the, these are the evidences or gene attributes which make the, how these two nodes are interacting. What they are, how, what exactly they do, just consider this block is a one of the texts, like research paper, and this is another paper, and this is three blocks are representing three different research papers. And this particular paper has gene A, and this is having gene B, and they are showing whether gene A or B are interacting, okay? This particular has information of gene A, and this is our particular paper has gene B information. So gene A, B must be interacting with the help of these text analytics, gene A, B. And then the same paper is third paper also there, where they are showing gene B is also interacting with gene C. So we have three genes, A, B, and C. And when we analyze using natural language processing or text mining, so these type of attributes are collected from these three papers. And you are collecting some information from paper one, like gene A is interacting with gene B. And we are collecting some information from paper three, where they're showing this gene C is also interacting with the gene B. Now collectively, we can say the gene A, B, C are interacting with each other with the help of these text mining. There are a lot of evidences are based on text mining. So you can have the table and they are also statistically validated. The score shows the significance level that the P50 is interacting with the MMD, MDM2, okay? And they are validated by these type of relationship. They are experimentally validated also. They have databases validation and then text mining validation. That's why they're really highly scored. Okay, I think we have 15 minutes more because I want to show them how to collect this data and then go to Cytoscape. I want to show something there.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
So this is the data we can get and this is the information we are getting from string. So what we can do more about this string, we can do this to do windows are very important, more or less. We want to grow this particular network. What other proteins are interacting with this particular network? Then you can click more. Automatically, this is a by default. There are some options that will try to analyze all other nodes as a query node and search different types of networks. That's in this first goal, as you can say. Now we are getting the number of nodes are getting increased. So what exactly we are doing, we are just growing the network with the presence of different types of nodes in the public databases like string. Then we can have a lot of analytic techniques are also used, like we have analysis column. We can do the same thing with less. If you don't want to cluster our network, we can do more or less thing, okay? This is a growing network and then thus your shrinking network. Third thing, which is very important. So this is called network statistics. So you have number of nodes, how many nodes are there and then how many edges are there, average number of edges, how node we can have. The statistical, these are all statistical variable. How many nodes are connected on an average with a single node. At least eight nodes are connecting with the single node. So there will be every node is connected with, at least with the eight nodes. So these are all the types of network statistics. One thing is very important. These are all relational databases that then you have a lot of different data is already annotated. So you got the functional enrichment of the same network. If you want to get a lot of other information from this network, then you can get these type of biological process. They are involved in, like this P53 network involved in cellular response. So these are the, again getting some relational databases called GoTerm. So they are getting this metadata from these Go, where they identify the molecular function, cellular component from where they are coming, these all proteins. Then they are also connected to the PubMed, what is publication. So a lot of huge data is also there. Now what we have to download, we have to download this information and export this information so that we can see these things in your CytoScape. So this is the different format I have already shown you. The CytoScape can have the format of TSV. So just click download and you will be getting this type of file where this format is called TSV format, okay? So you just open this file and this particular file is nothing, is a tab separated value, okay? So we'll be opening this particular file. This particular file has the network of P53. So before I will show you that network, I need to, discuss about this interface. So this is the CytoScape interface. They have three type of windows. Like this is a file handling window where you showing this the different type of file handling tools. Like network, and there are certain type of apps or tabs are also shown. This is the name, what you say, this is the main visualization window, okay? So the network will be visualized here. Then this is a table window, what is called node table, okay? So, and one thing is very, very important to understand, these are open source technology and mostly these are based on CytoScape.
I think I am not being able to see that CytoScape window which you are showing right now.
Okay, let me see what is the problem with that. Okay, wait. Can you see now
it is visible.
So this is a CytoScape window and that they have different types of tab. Like these are like a normal word, they have different type of functionality. First thing which is need to be shown, this is called layout. So layout is a different data visualization ways by which with a single network can be visualized. And the second thing is called apps. This app is a different, like I already told you, this is a CytoScape app, like the similar we have Android app. So we have Android platform and this Android platform has different multiple apps for different functionality. So the same way you have CytoScape app, when you can see search, so you can search. So there are different apps. I have already downloaded some of the app. You can see to the, there is short description of these apps also given to the app browser window. If you want to functionally enrichment of the collection, or we can do mass spectroscopy data, we want to and then analyze multiple omic analysis. So there are different types. So you can type your app name also, and then you will directly go to this. It's called app code. So we'll be demonstrating this type of particular app. It's called clustering app. How to club different types of networks. So now there are different ways we can open this and export network from file handling window to import and export. So you go to import and then there are network from file. Network from file or from table, we can say. So there are different types of ways by which we can open. So there are some window import tables from, okay. Let me see what is there. Okay, so this is called directly we already have this what you call TSV file format. So we just be downloading this type of
TSB file format, then now it is very important you are showing. This is all import network tribal file. So this Cytoscape need to understand what exactly these different type of proteins are there. So there, as you can say, there are different label. Automatically they are identifying it. So this is node 1, protein 1. This is node 2, protein 2, and how they are interacting, their relationship. So this is already automatically understand by this network. Otherwise, we have to identify. We have to annotate what is a target node, which is interacting node, and what is the relationship between edges. Okay, so this is a visualization. You can zoom and in, and then you can see a lot of different types of visualization. Now you can play with this type of visualization. Okay, then this same thing, you can see there are a lot of information. This is called node table. When you see, so these information are called node table. And then you have edge information, how these proteins are interacting, what is the interaction type, what is the different variable you can get from this, whether there's a co-expression. So there's homology, phylogenetic recurrence. So there are a lot of data is already there with the edges. How these edges are labeled and how their relationship. So there also can be mapped with this data. Second thing I want to show you, which is two of the things I will be demonstrating. I think it is 5 or 10 minutes. I can get an extension of, I think, maybe 5 to 10 minutes. Is that okay?
Yeah, please.
So I'll be showing you how to analyze these networks. So when you go to apps, and then there are a lot of things we can get. These are all different types of, what do you say, application or apps. So this is the one way by which we can download this particular network. And there is another way by which we can create a network from, what do you say, network from. There are a lot of interfaces. Like there are some application where they get data from these publicly available data, like string. So this is one of the very important application which from where we get these different type of data. Like you just click P53 and you want to download data from different types of sources. It is not like that you need to download only from PDB data. You need to download data of P53 from differential sources like PDB also, maybe the PDB genes also, SMP data or mutational data also. Maybe we have a clinical importance data. So there are a lot of huge number of data already there. So they are showing it. So you have P53 pathways. Right now I have downloaded this P53 pathways, or maybe download it from CAG or Reactome database. So we can download this data from different sources from the single interface called NEDE. This is also people are using for collecting data. So now this is a very interesting visualization you can see. Right now we have downloaded this P53 network from the pathway databases. Okay, then these are different types of visualization we can play with. There are different visualization ways with this data visualization can be done. Two of the things I need to show you. One is called how to analyze these data. So this is a data I need to analyze. Now why my hypothesis is there, I need to see the clusters of protein which is mostly and highly interacting in comparison to the other protein, which is lessly interacting, which is not so strongly interacting with each other. So what we can do, we can go for this very popular application called M-code. So we can go to M-code and we can select to analyze the whole network. So what they are doing, they are just going to do this, what do you say, they came in clustering or maybe hierarchical clustering. We can choose a lot of variables are there. How many nodes we can club, normally analysis, what sort of cluster you want. You want to include the loops within cluster, intra-cluster, inter-cluster. We can do a lot of variables. So what exactly they are doing it, when you analyze this type of data, we got this cluster. Yeah, this is the result. So these are the clusters. This is the top first cluster. We are having certain type of 3 nodes and 3 edges. And there is code also, because the network data is very less. So you are not getting that beautiful cluster analysis. just consider as in the case also, this also they must be very important nodes, very significant nodes in comparison to the ranked three clusters. And let's just consider P53 must be interacting with these two proteins mostly, and they are must be activator or inhibitor, we can say. So we can analyze, further analyze these type of protein interacting partners. So this is very basic and very simple type of analysis we can do with the cluster analysis. Then we have, I think we have more than 30 to 40 algorithm only deal with the cluster analysis. Okay. So you can explore a lot of things like SNP variations ke liye bhi hoga. There must be some algorithm like word cloud. This is very important and very interesting. What beautiful word cloud you see in the application. But then this is used for text analytics. You have this functional enrichment applications. Next thing I want to show you how to manipulate these type of network. I think somebody asking ki what is the difference in string and cytoscape. So this is the string I will be showing you. Okay. So this is our Windows. Okay. We go to the network and there are certain called network style. Network style is the how these two particular networks are being visualized. That is called style. So we can go to this network and then we can choose different styles. Right now, by default, you can say these are having different types of shapes of this network. So these can be manipulated and these can be mapped also. These two things are very important. If you want to analyze the same, I have shown you one of the network where they're showing that the differential expression genes are mapped with this normal network. Then you will see there are different shapes and color of this type of network. So from where you can get this type of data visualization? From this style window. What we can do with this style, we can map data with the edge node or whole network can be also different type of visualization. Like I will be showing you one of the, I think we can show you border width size. Okay. So this is a two type of windows are shown. This is called mapping windows. So right now I'm showing you can change a lot of different types of visualization. Like now we can change the type of visualization from different type of shapes we can choose. But it is more important to map. So now we want to analyze if this particular mapping data is already available. So what we can do, we can go to this map and then there are custom type or mapping type. What we can do with the discrete map and continuous map. Discrete map, if you have differential gene expression data, then you can just give you the pathway of this particular Excel file where you have the differential expression genes or different protein expression values of this whole network. And there are different type of nodes and you must be having some analysis where you have the protein expression data. So that data can be merged with this particular style window. You can go to nodes and then you can map with the shapes. And right now I think we don't have any data. Let me show if we can be mapped with the certain variable. Okay. So, like right now you have certain type of nodes information. Like we have these nodes are there and then certain type of information are already there. Some numerical information is mapped mostly. So these MAT scores we can mapping. I think there is no difference. That's why I'm not showing anything else. So what I was intended to show you, there are lot of variable can be mapped within the network table also. If you have edge table, network table, so these values can be mapped. Right now you can see there are a lot of information are given in the edge table. So edge table has a lot of information. So these can be mapped with this style windows. I think it is more than enough. I can stop here. And if you have any question, I would love to respond. Because there are a lot of things can be demonstrated. But now if you ask anything, then I can demonstrate right now. Okay, Pash, you can take on, and then I can take a few of the questions.
And, wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, for the wonderful talk. So friends, I think this has been a very scintillating talk. I'm sure, Ashok, you will also be there during the next few days. So please do these exercises. Cytoscape is absolutely a great joy to work with ever since it was launched in 2004. So please try to work with Cytoscape and M-Code. Any questions, please feel free to ask Ashok in the WhatsApp group. So let's thank Ashok for his scintillating talk and wonderful demonstration on Cytoscape. So please unmute your microphone and give a big round of applause, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ashok.
Okay. God bless you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye. Yeah, thank you. So friends, assuming that you have done or you will be doing this Cytoscape, I think I'm just trying to give you a kind of a demonstration from yesterday's point of view. Jeraman, sir, you are there for the next 15 minutes, right, sir?
Yes, I'm there, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. So I'll just quickly take 5 minutes. So yesterday we ran this particular command. What was that? This one, okay? So we generated something called ISAT2, where we have given HE38 as a reference, -1, FQ, and this thing. But we also built ISAT2 like this, okay? If you remember, okay? And now, you see, when I give ls-lrth, okay? So I'll give a *.ht2, which means all the files that are ending with ht2, okay? So you see, these four files are created. So these are all the HiSAT2 build files. And if you, add them up, all of them, will be somewhere, close to about, 3.2 GB of human genome 38 data sets. So there are 8 files that are created. Usually, 6 files are created. Usually 8 are created. I don't know why. Usually reverse files are also to be created. Okay. So, but don't worry with the number of files, but it will really be split into those equal number of files. Okay. And you see, I just want to see how this is done. So it will calculate and it will also go for reserving the size. Okay. It will create 8, anywhere between 6 to 8 files across the buckets. Okay. And the human genome 38 files are split up like this. Okay. So this is only for you to build the HiSAT2, just like the BOTY2 build that you have done. Okay. And now, once you have gotten these, you also have developed this, a SAM file, right? You also built a SAM file. Okay. So yeah, I think it's still working. Oh, I'm sorry, it is still working. Okay, that's the reason why it's taking some time. It says getting block 7 of 8. Okay, somehow the server is a bit slow. It's behaving a bit weird. Okay, and if you want to see the jobs, you can simply give htop. Okay, if you give htop, some of the jobs that are currently run can be seen. I don't think that job is still running, but there might be job that might be working from the end. Okay, so here. So you have got the HE38 build, and how to get the SAM file. Did anyone of you run the SAM file? I think yesterday we ran the SAM file. I don't know where it is. Let me see this. Okay, with the z14.sam. So let me see ls-lrth z14. Yeah, it's still running. It's not allowing me to run the command. I'm sorry. Okay. So it's still running. I'm sorry. I know I cannot show you the demo right now. I don't know why, what has really happened with the server. But let me go for SOS. I hope the server is not filled. Yeah, it's not filled. It's 76%. Okay. So I think, our server has become a bit slow because of the number of users, and our own jobs are also running. Okay. So that could be one of the reasons as well. So I'll just probably show you once this is done. So in the meantime, do you have any questions on LibSVM? Maybe Anubha might want to share the screen or show something from yesterday's exercise. Yeah.
So what will I have to show?
No, I just thought, you know, I think Jayaraman sir asked you to run with a different minuses, minus T option, and you ran breast cancer and you got some kind of, you know, good cross validation of 97.6 or something. But did you get a more efficient CV cross validation?
Okay, but after that, Jayaraman sir has asked me to run some more with changing the kernel values of that C and something like that G, I think, which I think will be applicable if I take that S value for 3 in that sigmoid kernel part. But I haven't been able to run that still yet. So,
right. Yeah. No problem. No problem, yeah.
Is there anything which say, if you want me to teach further on libs?